EWTNRC.com.
Each week, Jeanette DiMello and Dr. Matthew Bunsen bring light and clarity to the news and topics that affect your life. Register Radio, Saturday night, 7 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Good morning. This is an EWTN News Link. I'm Teresa Tomeo. It's Thursday after Ash Wednesday and the Feast of St. Gregory. President Trump placing Vice President Mike Pence in charge of overseeing the nation's response to the coronavirus threat, working with top health authorities. Some lawmakers are calling for much more money than the $2.5 billion the White House has requested to fund the response. The American Civil Liberties Union filing lawsuits against seven Texas cities that have declared themselves sanctuary cities for unborn children. The seven cities have all passed ordinances declaring that abortion will be illegal in the cities if Roe v. Wade were to be overturned. A federal judge ruling the nation's first supervised safe injection site can open in South Philadelphia, and operators of that site say it will be ready to open as soon as next week. U.S. Attorney William McSwain is hoping to appeal the ruling, saying it would violate the law and would lead to increased criminal activity in the area. A new lawsuit claims that Google security monitors the internet activity of children. The lawsuit, which was filed by the state of New Mexico, claims the company is using its education platforms to monitor private data, such as a child's physical location, the websites they visit, their search terms, and their passwords. And yesterday, Pope Francis calling on Catholics to go to confession during Lent to experience God's healing love. Before going to confession, the Holy Father recommending people should stand in front of the crucifix and contemplate Christ on the cross. For more news with a Catholic perspective, visit EWTNnews.com. I'm Teresa Tomeo, and Morning Glory starts now.
On the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network. Live from our nation's capital, this is Morning Glory. It's Catholic from coast to coast with Gloria Purvis, Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and Father Vincent DeRosa.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Prompt our actions with your inspiration, we pray, O Lord, and further them with your constant help, that all we do may always begin from you and by you be brought to completion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Blessed the man who follows not the counsel of the wicked, nor walks in the way of sinners, nor sits in the company of the insolent, but delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on his law day and night. He is like a tree planted near running water that yields its fruit in due season and whose leaves never fade. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked, not so. They are like chaff which the wind drives away. For the Lord watches over the way of the just, but the way of the wicked vanishes.
Yeah, that's a beautiful reflection. That's the very first psalm, the opening psalm of the Sefer Telahim, which is the book of sung praises, which the psalms are called in Hebrew. And what a wonderful reflection. Blessed the man, and the word there is Adam, actually, in Hebrew, is man, or I mean, you know, could be either man or woman. Mm-hmm. But the opening salvo, if you will, you know, the person is blessed who follows not our own way of thinking, not our own way of believing, but aligns their hearts and their minds according to the mind of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And that is the one who prospers in life. Something really wonderful to remember as we start Lent.
I think so, too. Well, you know what? I've gotten so many emails. I was going to do this lady for history, Black History Month, but and I was saving her to the end. And if you're wondering who I'm talking about, is Dr. Mildred Faye Jefferson. She's born in East Texas in 1927. She died October 15th, 2010, age 84. And if you're like, who is she? Well, let me just tell you a little bit about her background. She was an academic prodigy, Graduating from her local segregated high school at age 15, she later went on to become the first African-American woman to be accepted to Harvard Medical School, graduating in 1951. Her professional accomplishments went on from there. She also became the first woman of any race to complete a surgical rotation at Boston City Hospital and the first female surgeon at the Boston University Medical Center. She helped found the Massachusetts Citizens for Life, which was incorporated 4 days after the 1973 Roe v. Wade decision, and she co-founded the National Right to Life Committee, serving as its president for three terms from 1975 to 78. She was pro-life and began her work in the pro-life movement in the late 60s, but really got moving in the 70s when a fellow doctor called her and said, "Hey, I have a question. A local chapter of the American Medical Association is preparing a resolution in favor of abortion rights. Would you sign a petition against the resolution?" And she was like, "Not only will I sign it," but she did all these other things as well. She was an amazing person. She was quoted as saying, "Abortion on demand is not merely the right to choose. The demand is the right to choose to kill an unborn child and pay some doctor to do it. In a sound society, there are choices which we must agree not to make and not to allow." She was really inspirational. Another quote of hers, "I became a physician in order to save lives, not to destroy them. I will not accept the proposition that the doctor should relinquish the role of healer to become the new social executioner." And finally, just to let you know about her, she says she received numerous awards and multiple honorary degrees for her tireless defense of the unborn, including an honorary doctoral degree in humanities from the College of the Holy Cross, which she received alongside St. Teresa of Calcutta in 1976. She also spoke to the Knights of Columbus. She went to one of their conferences and was one of their speakers, but she really relished in seeing that she changed hearts and lives on the matter. And she, after appearing in a panel on TV on 1972, someone wrote her, and I want to read you the excerpt. This person says, and when he saw her in 72, he writes years later to her. He says, "Several years ago, I was faced with the issue of whether to sign a California abortion bill. I must confess to never having given the matter of abortion any serious thought until that time. No other issue since I have been in office has caused me to do so much study and soul searching. I wish I could have heard your views before our legislation was passed. You make it irrefutably clear that an abortion is a taking of a human life. I'm grateful to you." And that was from then Governor Ronald Reagan of California writing to her.
Wow.
So we remember Dr. Mildred Faye Jefferson for Black History Month. She was amazing.
I'm imagining a t-shirt with her face on it that says, "Prodigies are pro-life."
Oh, yeah. That's a good one, Father. Yeah, we're going to do that one. Good. "Prodigies are pro-life." That's a good one. She was a plain talking Texan, they say. She didn't mince words.
Very cool.
"Prodigies are pro-life." That's a good one. We're going to have a great show today. Lots of things that we're talking about. You know, this comes up again and again. So we're going to go over, why do Catholics not eat meat on Friday? We're going to talk about, why is it Friday? Why fish is not meat? And then, you know, then why is it that we actually don't eat meat? So we're going to talk about that today on the show. What else are we talking about?
We'll be discussing some different ways in which the virtue of love it can be exemplified by parish priests. And I've got three stories from some of our early pastors here at St. Mary's who were just rock stars of the virtue of love.
Beautiful.
And we'll also talk about, should the sacraments of initiation, baptism, confirmation, and Holy Eucharist be restored to their proper order in the Latin Church? Because, you know, a lot of places right now, it's baptism, then Eucharist, then confirmation as a teenager. So we'll talk about that.
And, of course, we'd love to hear from you. If you can reach out to us on Instagram, just do a search for Morning Glory. Well, there's a lot to talk about in the headlines. I understand. I saw a video yesterday of Pope Francis. Looks like he was walking from to St. Sabina Church. He looked like he was having a little bit of, I mean, it was a distance. But I understand there's something up with these stational churches in Rome.
Yeah, so the 40 days of Lent are marked by 40 station churches. In the ancient church, these were typically the 40 oldest churches in the city, or the oldest parishes, anyway, to have that title. Mm-hmm. And what would happen was each of them was associated with a different martyr. And so throughout the course of Lent, the Bishop of Rome would go and make visits to each of these parish churches to honor the martyrs, keep the ancient memories, and link the idea of Lent with pilgrimage and with total self-sacrifice and giving yourself over to Jesus. And so that has begun. Now, about 1,000 years ago, the practice kind of fell out, you know, of practice. And it's what's really cool is that over the last 30 years or so, it's American seminarians from the Pontifical North American College who have revivified the practice. And so today, you will, every day of Lent, you will see a column of about 200 English speakers, seminarians and visitors and university students who are studying abroad and so on. You'll see them making their silent pilgrimage through the city before dawn, going to each of these churches to celebrate Mass, pray with the martyrs, and keep the Lenten pilgrimage of the station churches. So it's just an amazing thing, and it's cool to see that beginning with the Pope's own visit to Santa Sabina.
I heard it was around for years, but it was Pope St. Gregory the Great that established the actual order in which the churches are to be visited, the prayers are recited. And so Ash Wednesday, I didn't realize that it's in a particular order. Santa Sabina is the church that they're supposed to do on Ash Wednesday. And then today, San Giorgio al Vallabro is supposed to
That's correct.
They do on Thursday. And then Friday, Santa Giovanni e Paolo. Then Friday, Sant Agostino. I wish they just had him in English. But, you know, it's Italian. They speak Italian, right?
Well, and there's some wonderful books that have been published. One of them is by George Weigel, which is this great book that has not only the churches and their history, but some spiritual reflections on each one of them. That's excellent.
Yeah. Oh, awesome. Well, that's interesting that this is such an ancient practice and they're doing it there in Rome. What a witness for everybody. That's wonderful. Now, I understand we have a story that's not so wonderful about a young child and being taken off life support. What's that about, Deacon?
Yep. Here we go back to jolly old England. They seem to have a problem with children over there. You know, we had Charlie Gard.
Oh,
and then
yeah.
Alfie Evans.
Yeah.
And now we have a third child, Mirdar Ali. This was a child who was born in September of last year, but suffered severe brain damage when complicates because the umbilical cord wrapped around his neck and starved him of oxygen. He was 4 months old, considered severely brain damaged, and the courts decided that he was brain dead. And so they decided to remove him from life support. Again, you know, his parents did not want it. And what's interesting, this time, U.S. ethicist and priest, Father Tad Pohalchik, chimed in.
Oh, okay.
Because the England's definition of brainstem death does not conform to the definition of brainstem death that the rest of the world has. So, who is this priest to say? Well, let's just put it like this. He has undergraduate degrees in philosophy, biochemistry, molecular cell biology, chemistry, and he has a doctorate in PhD, a PhD in neuroscience from Yale, did postgraduate work at Stanford, and worked at Harvard Medical School before going to Rome and getting a degree in dogmatic theology with emphasis in bioethics. So I think the man knows what he's talking about.
Mm-hmm. I think he does, too. And I tell you, sometimes I wonder what's going on in the world. I don't know. It's so hard to hear something like that, you know? It's really hard to hear that they do that to a child. But I don't know. I don't know if you had anything you want to add to that.
I don't get it. You know, I really don't. I mean, so he's really brave. But, you know, I mean, there's other things that could be done. But England's just not allowing it. They just decide this child's going to die. We don't care what anybody says. We don't care what the parents say, because we're the parent, the state, we're the parents now. We decide what's in that child's best interest, not the actual biological parents.
Well, I think if you think about what one of the things that our Holy Father once said, he said, when no one is at fault, everyone is at fault, right? And sometimes we create these sort of government and societal systems such that, well, nobody's at fault. I mean, this is just the law and this is the way to. But when that happens, everybody's at fault, and we all need to take an important look at that and how we govern our medical ethics.
Yes,
yeah,
indeed.
Absolutely.
Well, Well, a little bit of good news. There was a couple. good for them. I mean, you hear this. There's a couple, Carol Kaparsky and Ian Irwin. They're married, and they were last seen February 14th at a vacation cottage near a place called Inverness, a town at the foot of the bay. They never checked out the next day as planned, and so it took a week, but people found them huddled together, and they had survived off eating pond ferns and drinking muddy from a muddy puddle, but they were found alive. They were age 77 and age 72. Carol was 77, Erin was 72. So they were found alive. That's good news. And we have coming up next, we'll talk about why Catholics do not eat meat on Friday. And you can email us at morningglory.com.
Want to see the Morning Glory team in person? Check out road shows at EWTNMorningGlory.com. Morning Glory, it's Catholic from coast to coast. The Venerable Fulton John Sheen.
If we wish to keep our rights and liberties, we must also keep our God. Piety and patriotism go together. That's the first glory of being an American.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
This is Brian Kemper, a priest for life with Pro-Life Update. Some people think that because men cannot get pregnant, they have no right to say anything about abortion. But any human being, male or female, has the right and duty to speak up when someone's life is in danger. Real men don't stand around with their hands at their side when innocent babies are being ripped apart. They do something to defend these children. Saying that only women should have any say about abortion is like saying that only Jews can speak about the Holocaust, or only blacks can speak about segregation, or only children can speak about child abuse. The truth is that every human being can speak about human rights and has the duty to defend those rights when they are under attack. This is Brian Kemper on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
Listen to EWTN Radio day or night. Audio On Demand brings you your favorite EWTN programs instantly to you for free. Download the EWTN app today at EWTNapps.com.
Text us. Text the letters EWTN to 55000. Wait for a response. Then text your first name, how you're listening, and your comment. Morning Glory. It's Catholic from coast to coast.
Well, Lent has begun. And if you're looking for great gifts for Lent and Easter, and at the same time want to support EWTN's mission and Mother Angelica, go to the EWTN Religious Catalog. That's your online destination for all kinds of awesome Catholic books and DVDs and rosaries and devotionals, holy reminders. And you can get great stuff like Father William Casey's great book, Making a Holy Lent, 40 Meditations to Prepare You for the Church's Holiest Season. Buy Catholic. Shop EWTNRC.com. Again, that's EWTNRC.com. So, Gloria, why why do Catholics not eat meat on Fridays during Lent? And if I'm not mistaken, like I said, my mom, when we were growing up, we also didn't eat meat on Wednesdays and Fridays. But I don't know what happened with that. But I know Fridays for sure.
Yeah, Ash Wednesday and Good Friday are obligatory days of fasting and abstinence. So you're abstaining from meat on those days. And then every Friday in Lent, you also are to abstain from meat. And so some people might say, well, who? And it's not everybody. It's just Catholics from age 14 up are the ones that are, you know, abstain from eating meat for you. So your little ones can still eat meat if y'all want to make a meatless meal and one with meat for the little ones. But let's talk about, first of all, why Friday? Because, you know, I think this still keeps coming up, and we have to remember, well, the USCC says like this, Catholic people from time immemorial have set apart Friday for special penitential observance by which they gladly, y'all, that's your attitude you're supposed to have during these penances.
Gladly,
suffer with Christ that they may one day be glorified with him. And that's the heart of the tradition of abstinence from meat on Friday, where we observe it in the church. And since it's believed that Christ suffered and died on the cross on a Friday, Christians from the very beginning have set aside that day to unite their sufferings with Christ. And so this has led the church to really recognize every Friday is a Good Friday, where Christians can remember Christ's passion by offering up a specific type of penance. And for most of the church's history, it was meat, and they singled that out as a worthy sacrifice on account of its, you know, people think of meat feast, you know, I'm going to have meat, I'm going to have bacon, you know, and since it's usually associated with a lot of feasts and celebrations, they're like, this is a good sacrifice to give up, would be meat. And in some cultures, it's a delicacy, the fattened calf, you know, that kind of stuff. And even in scripture, you wouldn't slaughter a fattened calf until there was a celebration. So since we're not celebrating on Fridays and it's thought of as a day of penance and mortification, eating meat on a Friday to celebrate the death of Christ just didn't seem right. Now, let me just say, for Lent, if St. Patrick's Day falls on a Friday during Lent, it's considered a solemnity for many. And so the bishop in your, wherever your diocese is, can lift the not eating meat thing. But, you know, we should talk about why it's on Friday first, but then we can get more into meat. Now, remember, Christ suffered his passion on Friday, and we want to suffer with him. I didn't know if you guys wanted to add anything or say anything about that on Fridays.
Well, I'll say that the fasting rules, somebody was joking with me and said, you know, with these fasting regulations, they make it so complicated. It's like only people between the ages of 14 and 62 when the moon is full and in its third house. And here's the thing. It seems very minimal. And that's only because when it comes to putting in place a requirement, right, the church only puts in place on paper the most minimal requirements to make it easiest for people to gain access to grace. That does not mean we are limited to those minimal requirements, right? So if you're 65 and running the New York Marathon every year, you should not be eating meat on Fridays, okay?
Yeah.
Because you're clearly capable of handling more than the minimal requirements. Likewise, the 13-year-old, you know, a 13-year-old can handle not eating meat on Friday, you know, you know, unless they had some strange dietary reason not to. But...
Yeah.
So we don't have to be minimal, but that's the reason behind why sometimes these requirements, people say, well, why aren't the bishops stronger? Well, no, it's that they're trying to make it absolutely as easy as possible for people to gain access to grace. But that doesn't mean that your conscience can't poke at you and say, you know what, you can handle more than this, you know?
And even, let me just be clear. It's if for not eating meat is age 14 and up, and for abstaining during the fast is age 18 to 59. But, you know, that is a good point. If you are called to do more and you can do more, why not? I didn't know, Deacon, if you had anything you wanted to say there.
Well, when we were kids, we didn't eat meat on Wednesdays and Fridays. It didn't kill us. You know what I mean? Macaroni and cheese and, you know, or fish sticks or something like that. I mean, come
so
on.
So thin and so malnourished. And...
Well, you know, I think that's a lot of people ask about those things. And I see we got a text from Kathy. Are coffee and tea acceptable to drink in between meals on fast days like Ash Wednesday and Good Friday?
Oh, I got one on that. I got an answer on that.
Yeah.
Can I give an answer on that? Okay.
Please.
The most scientific answer I've heard is that coffee and tea constitute negative calories. In other words, your body actually takes more to burn them than it does than they actually bring to you. Therefore, they have no nutritive value. Therefore, they don't constitute violation of the fast. But I will tell you, my old canon-law professor, he put it this way, because he was talking about the Eucharistic fast before Mass, right? You know, the hour before Mass. And he said, look, if it's the difference between you having a cup of tea before Mass and you falling over on the altar or getting cranky in your homily, for the love of God, have the cup of tea.
Have your cup of tea.
He was this wonderful, clammy old Irishman. But
you know, let me ask you this, because I know some people drink coffee and tea. And with their coffee, they put these fancy creamers and all that stuff in it. What do you think about that kind of stuff? Do you think they need to be with the spirit of the law and the letter of the law? Like the coffee and tea shouldn't be some, like, you know, go to Starbucks and get your fancy stuff from your barista with all this, you know, foamed cream. All that kind of stuff. Yeah. Not like it's a dessert, you know.
I think that's a beautiful way to to do it. You know, it's like, yeah, have your coffee, but have a straight black cup of coffee and a small one. You know, spend $1 instead of $6 on your coffee today.
Yeah. So have your coffee, you say, but let's not have it be fancy. Just strong and black and tea. No clotted cream, y'all. Just have your plain tea or whatever. But then there's a question of, well, then how, you know, why is fish not meat? And we talked about this, but I'm going to say it again. According to the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, abstinence laws consider that meat comes only from animals such as chicken, cow, sheep, or pig, all of which live on land. Birds are also considered meat. They don't consider fish. Now, this is according to the church abstinence laws. This is not according to some kind of scientific genus. You know what I mean? So fish are a different category of meat. So are salt and freshwater species of fish. Also, amphibians, reptiles, cold-blooded animals, and shellfish are permitted. And I talked about people eating muskrat, beaver, capybara, even sweet little puffins, y'all, those beautiful little the birds. So it just depends on your diocese what they will allow, because puffins, I guess, have this water land sort of thing. But I was like, well, don't ducks too? But anyway, it depends on what your diocese will, you know, write out. Muskrats, some people eat muskrats. But I did have a friend, Dr. Gracie Christie, who's a friend of Morning Glory, say she and her husband argue over snails, whether or not snails are allowed. And I'm like, doesn't that thing crawl around outside and have tentacles? And it has a shell on its back, but I looked it up. It's actually a mollusk. But I'd really be interested if we have any listeners from France, because I know they eat snails sauteed in butter and garlic. So I'm wondering what they do, what their dioceses consider snails for Lent. Just curious about that. So that's why we eat fish. That's why we eat and different kinds of things that aren't meat. And we hope that people text us, text the letters EWTN to 55000. Tell us your first name, how you're listening, and your comment. And please note, message and data rates may apply. You might like this one, Father. It says, in Latin, the word used to describe what kind of meat is not permitted on Fridays is carnis, and specifically relates to animal flesh, and never included fish as part of the definition. So they also say fish is not considered celebratory in many cultures. So it was more of a penance to eat it.
And I think that makes a good point. You know, it's like, what is something that we cut out of our diet so that it's noticeable? You know, these things were never meant to sort of cripple us, right? Mm-hmm. So you have your fish fry instead of your meat, and people say, oh, well, I'm still so full from the fish fry. This wasn't really – well, it's not meant to, you know, like have you crawling on the ground, you know, struggling and reaching for food like you came out of the desert, you know, for goodness sake. Right. But it's meant to be a little – it's just a sort of a prick. A prick at the awareness, a prick at our consciousness that says, hey, it's Lent. What really matters? Where are we really putting our focus, you know, et cetera? Now, if somebody wants to engage in much more extreme asceticism, that's fine. And particularly under the guidance of a spiritual guide and so on and so forth, we know in the experience of the saints that can be a great gift. But that's not the point of this meat versus that meat versus fish versus, you know.
Well, let me just say this. We got a question for somebody on YouTube saying they're doing Lent, but can they eat Impossible Burgers and Beyond Meat? Those things are meatless. Those things are meatless, so yes, you can eat them. So we have coming up next what, Father?
We're going to be talking about the virtue of love in the lives of our parish priests.
A hot coffee, a warm fire, and Morning Glory. It's Catholic from coast to coast.
Father Wade Menezes.
The Father himself gauges his son, capital G, as the most perfect one to act in his stead. He whom the Father himself sent into the world.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
Lent, a season for prayer, fasting, and almsgiving.
Lent is, yes, a time of reflection, and it's a hard time sometimes, but I really look forward to the liturgies of the Triduum. It takes us back to the beginning when God created the earth out of his great love for us, and to the time, unfortunately, of the crucifixion where Jesus offered himself for us, then to the wonderful happiness of Easter and the resurrection.
60 on 10 with Monsignor Charles Pope.
The Sixth Commandment, you shall not commit adultery.
This commandment is wide-ranging in its implications. It forbids us not only from committing the very act of adultery, but also other sexual sins such as fornication or premarital sex, watching pornography, and speaking lewdly. Likewise, homosexual acts and acts of masturbation are also forbidden us. And the Lord himself even enjoins us to a purity of mind that we should not freely entertain lustful thoughts. And so it's wide-ranging, it's challenging, but it's in service of the great sacredness of human life, which comes from sexual activity. So we thank God for this great gift of sexuality, and we ask for his grace to live it with great reverence. The sixth commandment, you shall not commit adultery.
For more about the Ten Commandments, visit EWTNRC.com.
How do you define materialism?
Share your take on today's Take Two with Jerry and Debbie at noon Eastern.
Now let's return to Morning Glory. EWTN News headlines are next.
Good morning. This is an EWTN Newslink. I'm Teresa Tomeo. It's Thursday after Ash Wednesday and the Feast of St. Gregory. President Trump placing Vice President Mike Pence in charge of overseeing the nation's response to the coronavirus threat, working with top health authorities. Some lawmakers are calling for much more money than the $2.5 billion the White House has requested to fund the response. The American Civil Liberties Union filing lawsuits against seven Texas cities that have declared themselves sanctuary cities for unborn children. The seven cities have all passed ordinances declaring that abortion will be illegal in the cities if Roe v. Wade were to be overturned. A federal judge ruling the nation's first supervised safe injection site can open in South Philadelphia, and operators of that site say it will be ready to open as soon as next week. U.S. Attorney William McSwain is hoping to appeal the ruling, saying it would violate the law and would lead to increased criminal activity in the area. A new lawsuit claims that Google security monitors the internet activity of children. The lawsuit, which was filed by the state of New Mexico, claims the company is using its education platforms to monitor private data, such as a child's physical location, the websites they visit, their search terms, and their passwords. And yesterday, Pope Francis calling on Catholics to go to confession during Lent to experience God's healing love. Before going to confession, the Holy Father recommending people should stand in front of the crucifix and contemplate Christ on the cross. For more news with a Catholic perspective, visit EWTNnews.com. I'm Teresa Tomeo. Now, back to Morning Glory.
On the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network. Live from our nation's capital, this is Morning Glory. It's Catholic from coast to coast with Gloria Purvis, Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and Father Vincent DeRosa.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Loving Mother of the Redeemer, Gate of Heaven, Star of the Sea, assist your people who have fallen yet strive to rise again. To the wonder of nature, you bore your Creator, yet remained a virgin after as before. You who received Gabriel's joyful greeting, have pity on us poor sinners. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord is just in all his ways and holy in all his deeds. The Lord is close to all who call him, who call on him in truth.
You know, we need to remember that when we call out to the Lord in prayer and ask him for something and the way he responds isn't what we necessarily asked for. Remember, he's holy in all his ways and he's just. And he doesn't see as we see because he can see it all. We can't. And when I hear this part of the Psalm, Deacon, I really think it's calling us to trust in him and to remember that his ways are above our ways. Was there a reason you picked that particular Psalm?
A kind of continuation of Psalm 145, just Psalm of David. This is in the very last five books of the Psalms. This one called the Deuterohallel Psalms, or the second praise Psalms. And I just felt like, you know, we should be praising God. It's the start of Lent. I know it's penitential, but we should be grateful to God that we even have the ability to be able to practice our faith freely. Some of our brothers and sisters do not. And we should give praise and thanks to God for that and pray for those who don't.
Amen. Well, we're getting close to the end of Black History Month. And I'm going to talk about Dr. Mildred Faye Jefferson. She's born in East Texas in 1927. She was an academic prodigy. She graduated from her local segregated high school at age 15. She later went on to become the first African-American woman to be accepted to Harvard Medical School, graduating in 1951. She went on then to also become the first woman of any race to complete a surgical rotation at Boston City Hospital and the first female surgeon at the Boston University Medical Center. She became active in the pro-life movement in the 60s and 70s, but she became super active. One of her colleagues, a doctor, called her up and said, "Hey, the American Medical Association is going to prepare a resolution in favor of abortion. Will you sign a petition against it?" Well, not only did she sign a petition against it, she helped found the Massachusetts Citizens for Life, which was incorporated 4 days after the 1973 Roe v. Wade decision. She also co-founded the National Right to Life Committee and served as its president for three terms from 1975 to 78. And while she was the National Right to Life Committee president, she gave remarks at the 94th Knights of Columbus Supreme Convention, which was hosted in Boston in 1976. She has been quoted as saying, "Abortion on demand is not merely the right to choose. The demand is the right to choose to kill an unborn child and pay some doctor to do it. In a sound society, there are choices which we must agree not to make and not to allow." She also is quoted as saying, "I became a physician in order to save lives, not to destroy them. I will not accept the proposition that the doctor should relinquish the role of healer to become the new social executioner." She received numerous degrees and awards, and she also got an honorary doctorate degree in humanities from the College of the Holy Cross alongside St. Teresa of Calcutta. But she was also very proud of the moments when she can convert people. And one of her converts wrote her after seeing her on a television panel in 1972. The convert said, "Several years ago, I was faced with the issue of whether to sign a California abortion bill. I must confess to never having given the matter of abortion any serious thought until that time. No other issue since I've been in office has caused me to do so much study and soul searching. I wish I could have heard your views before our legislation was passed. You made it irrefutably clear that an abortion is a taking of a human life. I'm grateful to you." And that person she converted on the life issue and who wrote her was then Governor Ronald Reagan of California. Dr. Mildred Faye Jefferson died October 15th, 2010 at age 84. Remarkable woman.
Yes, absolutely.
Remarkable woman. So that's your Black History fact. You know, what do we have coming up after this segment, Deacon?
Well, we're going to talk about, should the sacraments of initiation be restored to their proper order in the Latin Church, baptism, confirmation, and then Holy Eucharist.
Mm-hmm. So, Father, we're going to talk about the virtue of love. Is that it? Did I get that right?
Yeah. You know, the last couple of weeks I've been meditating on hope and on faith, and now we come to the queen of all the virtues, which is love. Mm. And so let's talk about love. And the way that I was meditating on this with my people was in the lives of three of our early rock star pastors, Father Alig, Father Glob, and Father Roth. And, in St. Paul's famous letter to the Corinthians quote about, you know, if I have not love, I have nothing. Mm-hmm. He talks about, you know, different stuff. So, like, for example, Father Alig was an immigrant to this country. He came here from Switzerland to found our parish. Oh. And so the guy gave up his own country, right? Why? Mm-hmm. So that he could serve the German-speaking community here in Washington way back in 1845, which was not exactly an easy time to, you know, to come over and make such a big change. Not only that, but Father Alig came from a wealthy farming family. So when he came here and started up our parish, it was on a tiny piece of land. He enlarged it by giving up his family's inheritance in order to build an orphanage and a school. Serving the orphan, doing all these things, giving up, even if I give up everything that I have, St. Paul says, if I have not love, I have nothing. Mm. And that's really what caused, you know, this parish to grow. It was not Father Alec's gift, but his love for his people, which was so obvious to folks. How obvious was it? He went from 20 families when he started the parish to 2,000 when he died. Mm. That's really cool. 2,000 households. Then there was Father. Go ahead.
Gloria. I was going to say what I like that this love really is rooted in the sacrifice that he made. I mean, he could have had a different life, but out of love of giving up his wealth and going to serve the people. I mean, that we need that witness of love in today's world, because love is a very different thing now. Love is just a feeling, and the minute it's gone, well, I'm out of this marriage because, you know, love didn't laugh. I lost that love and feeling, baby. So I'm out of here. Right? So, but
love
this
is a decision.
Right. Yes. Love is an act of the will, right? It's an act of the will to love. And I'm so glad we're talking about this. Deacon, I didn't mean to cut you off. I didn't know if you were going to say something.
Oh, no. I think it's what a beautiful witness. You know, just like a father of a family, you know, would sacrifice for the good of the family. And the wonderful to hear the beautiful history of priests doing the same thing for their family, their parish family.
Amen.
Well, one of our next pastors, Father Glob, was one of the first people to receive a doctorate from the Catholic University of America. His brilliance was such that Cardinal Gibbons asked him to begin the cause of canonization for Elizabeth Ann Seton. He was on the original team that investigated her life. And but for all of his brilliance and so on, that wasn't ultimately what solidified his place in parish history. Father Glob was going around doing an ordinary parish priest thing. He was visiting the sick. And you talk about love as a decision, right? I will tell you, no parish priest likes visiting the sick. We do it. We choose to do it. We like carrying out our duty, right? Mm-hmm. But your body tells you this person's sick. I should not be near this person, right? You have to decide to overcome that feeling and be at the bedside of the sick, right? And Father Glob did that. He eventually contracted that one of the diseases of one of the dying people that he was visiting with, and died of it himself at the age of 37.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So young.
Gave his life in order to minister to his people in his parish.
Wow.
But, you know, like Deacon, like you're saying, and both of you are parents, you both know this, when your children are sick, you go to them.
Oh, right? Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
Oh, yes. You're with them, and you suffer with them, and you want them to get better, and all the care that they need, you do. You gladly do it because you love them. Even when people are like, ooh, your child got this and that and the other. And you're like, well, yeah, I love them. That's why I'm not abandoning them to their sickness, you know, alone. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Well, how have Morning Glory listeners seen the virtue of love in your life? Just text the letters EWTN to 55000. Wait for response. It takes your first name, how you're listening, and your comment. Remember that message and data rates may apply.
Can I tell you how I've seen the virtue of love from a priest in my life? One of my sisters was killed in a car accident. It was terrible. She's young. She's in her 20s. And I have to say, I think that has to be a really hard time to be with a family during such a tragic, terrible death. But I remember Father Figaro, because I was in college at the time. I was younger than her. I remember Father Figaro meeting me at the airport to get me, because I had to leave school and fly home after finding out that my sister was tragically killed. And the way he just walked with me, the way he walked with my non-Catholic parents, helping them plan a wake and a funeral mass and all this stuff, to really be there in the midst of this intense suffering and grief. And he didn't leave, not for 1 minute, whereas a lot of people want to run and not be around you when you have this, you know, frankly, at that time seemed like this inconsolable grief. He never once left our family's side. And I really love Father Figaro for that and many other reasons. But I mean, may his soul rest in peace. But you know, he was with us. He was with my parents, and they weren't Catholic, so he had a lot. And my sister was. My sister was a Catholic. And so he really walked with them and helped them understand everything from the church's perspective. And I have to say, that was intense and a witness to me now that I look back at it as a virtue of love from this priest.
There's one last story I want to tell. It's the story of Father Roth. And Father Roth was the pastor of our parish during World War I, which was not an easy time to be the pastor of a German-speaking parish and to preach in German and pray in German. But Father Roth was exiled from the capital. There was a law passed in Washington midway through the war that non-citizen Germans needed to leave Washington. And so he was kicked out of the very city that he was working to serve. And when the war ended, he came back and he continued to serve the very same city and the very same people. So beautiful stories of these immigrant pastors, these orphan pastors, these pastors who gave up their lives in order to love their people. Just wonderful. So pray for your priests and pray for the souls of these holy men who have gone before us, because they got no one to pray for them except us.
Amen. And, you know, I hope maybe there's some listeners can write in about their own witness of their priest, you know, other things, you know, or whatever they witness of virtue of love. Maybe they have stories about their priest that they want to share with us. You can email us, morningglory@ewtn.com. Tell us your first name, how you're listening, and your comment. I'd love to hear those stories. I know they're out there. But, you know, I think about praying for priests, especially during the month of November, making sure we pray for them every day for the month we remember our dead. So what do we have coming up next, Deacon?
We're going to talk about the sacraments of initiation, baptism, confirmation, and Holy Eucharist be restored to their proper order in the Latin Church. There's some vigorous discussion about that, and so we'll talk about it. And don't forget to email us, morningglory@ewtn.com. Leave us your first name and your comment.
Morning Glory podcasts are available 24/7 at EWTNMorningGlory.com. Morning Glory, it's Catholic from coast to coast.
Here comes today's quote from Mother Angelica's perpetual calendar. Disobedience, rudeness, lack of compassion to our neighbor, selfishness, haughtiness. All of this is pride. These are serious things. These are false things. Mother Angelica's perpetual calendar features an inspirational message for each day of the year. It's available from the EWTN religious catalog at EWTNRC.com.
It's time for Family Man with Dr. Gregory Popchuk.
Anxiety disorders affect 20% of Americans, and many take anti-anxiety medications in an attempt to find relief. But surprisingly, a new study from the University of New Zealand examining the effectiveness of different types of anxiety therapies found that compared with using medication alone to treat anxiety, or even medication combined with therapy, anxious patients who received cognitive behavior therapy alone experienced the most relief of all three groups. The study found that anxious patients can tend to lean too heavily on medication to help them feel calm, and because of that, can struggle to develop the skills therapy could otherwise afford them. By contrast, patients who received counseling alone worked harder to learn skills that helped them create a more peaceful life. If you're suffering from anxiety but not currently receiving counseling, contact a faithful therapist who can make sure you're getting the best care possible. I'm Dr. Greg Popchuk, but you can call me Family Man.
To discover more ways faith can enrich your life, visit CatholicCounselors.com.
Email us, morningglory@ewtn.com. Morning Glory, it's Catholic from coast to coast.
We are Catholic from coast to coast, and you're with us on the Vigil of Friday. You know, that's what I call Thursday. Do y'all know that I call that the Friday Vigil?
Vigil of Friday. Right?
Some people are like, oh gosh, can I get to the last day, my last work day? So I'm Gloria Purvis. I'm joined by my good friends, Father Vincent DeRosa. He's the pastor of St. Mary's Church in Chinatown in Washington, D.C., and also the dynamic Deacon Harold Burke Sivers. And you know what, listeners? We'd like for you to tell us how to make Morning Glory better. Is it even possible? I think it might be. How can you do that? Visit EWTNMorningGlory.com. Look for the Morning Glory mug. It'll be a black mug on the page. You scroll around till you find it. Once you find it, click on that mug and then take the Morning Glory 60-second survey. So, Deacon, what's up with this order of the sacraments? What was the? I think I remember the original order. Can I guess?
Yeah, go ahead.
Baptism, confirmation, then Eucharist.
That's right.
Is that right? That's right.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. And as we know in the church today, they're at least in the Latin rite, they're out of order. We just have baptism, the first communion, then confirmation. We want to hear what our Morning Glory listeners think. Let us know. Text the letters EWTN to 55000. Wait for response to text your first name, how you're listening, and your comment. So for the first 500 years or so, the sacraments of initiation were received together. In fact, in the Eastern rites that are part of the Catholic Church, the Maronites and a lot of the Byzantine ones, they still give all three sacraments of initiation to infants. There was a historical reasons why it got out of order. Part of it was because they were responding to the Jansenist heresy. And the Bishop Jansen said that people weren't worthy to receive the sacraments, so they stopped receiving the sacraments. In order to combat that, the Pope at the time established an age of reason to, or an age to receive First Communion. Now, the problem is the one who in the Latin Rite that can do confirmation is the bishop. And so you would be baptized. You would have to wait for the bishop to make his way to your town, and then you'd be confirmed, and then you would receive Holy Eucharist. But when in fighting this heresy, you would get baptism, then you receive First Communion. And when the bishop finally made his way around to your town or to your village for confirmations, then you would get confirmed. Although we do keep the original order. During the Easter Vigil. Mm-hmm. So when people are brought into the church during the Easter Vigil, we have the original order of baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist. And so there's some thought as to bringing that back, bringing that original order back, and which I, quite frankly, am a proponent of as well. So there's two schools of thoughts on this. One saying, well, you know, we should have confirmation later because we need to have something for the young people when they're older, you know. But quite frankly, if we're honest, in a lot of places, confirmation has become Catholic graduation for a lot of our teenagers. There's a serious disconnect between their faith and their everyday lived experience. I'd rather see them get all the sacraments and then teach them the rest of their lives how to cooperate with the grace of the sacraments instead. Mm-hmm. So, but there's some dioceses that have moved in this direction. Restoring all the sacraments initiation to proper order. So you receive baptism when you're an infant, and then your confirmation, and then First Communion. So, for example, Bishop James Wall in the Diocese of Gallup, New Mexico, started going back to the original order. Also, the Archdiocese of Denver has also initiated going back to the original order as well. So it's just interesting to hear what we think about that.
How does that work? So how do they give it to – because I imagine babies, right, can receive all three, right, in the mm-hmm. Eastern Rite, right, when mm-hmm. you're baptized and confirmed. I just was wondering about the mechanics of it.
Yeah, it's just confirmation. I mean, because the priest does it during the Easter Vigil. So he has
No, I mean, like, for little people. Like, do they do all three at once?
Oh, I see. I mean, is there a rite where they actually do the
all three together at once?
Well, it's like, yeah, so it's they're individual rites, but they're done right after each other. Because I've been to one Byzantine one and I saw that, so it was pretty awesome.
Was it with a baby, or?
Yeah.
I mean, I think Well, and for a kid, I mean, you could still do the same thing the bishops do now. You can go from church to church to church. It's just that instead of doing it in eighth grade, you could do it in, say, first grade or, you know, something like that, you know.
Yeah. I think there's always people always talk about, what about the age of reason? But the grace of the sacraments work regardless of our knowledge, right?
Yes, exactly. The sacraments are dependent on our knowledge. It's from the work worked. Is how that is, but the key is cooperating with the grace of the sacraments. So if they receive the sacraments when they're young, then catechesis just has become, okay, now we do it at this age. Now we do it at this age. No, it should be a continuum. We're constantly teaching our children about the faith and cooperating and growing in grace and not just at particular times in their adolescence.
And theologically and pastorally, think about it this way. Because the theology really is on the side of restoring the original order of the sacraments. Baptism gets you into the deal, right? It begins giving you the graces of the Holy Spirit, incorporates you into Christ. Confirmation perfects those gifts of the Holy Spirit within you. They are two connected and yet distinct moments, right? The giving of the gifts and the perfecting of the gifts. The reason why the order was baptism, confirmation, then Eucharist, is because really Eucharist has nothing to do with the mere reception of Holy Communion. Eucharist was the first time that you, fully conscious and armed with the tools that the church could give you through baptism and confirmation, you could then go to Mass and offer your sacrifice fully because you had all the tools with which to offer it, right? Mm-hmm. It was about mission. It was about transforming the way that you think about your day-to-day life into, yeah, my day-to-day life is my sacrifice, which I then bring to God on Sunday at the altar in the celebration of the Eucharist, at the end of which, as sort of the cherry on the sundae, if I'm ready for it, I can receive Holy Communion, you know? So the theology really is on the side of this order of the sacraments because, yeah, there's no such thing as Catholic graduation. I mean, that's...
Right.
The thing of it is, and I'm just saying this in my own personal experience, every argument I've ever heard in favor of the current predominant order, with confirmation being last, comes down to parents will be angry with us if... ... That's
really?
The only thing I've ever heard. Oh, yeah. Nobody has ever said to me, well, here's the beautiful theological reason or what Saint so-and-so said about this or whatever. It's
right.
always, if we move this, parents won't be able to have the party with the kids and they'll be angry with us. Or we'll never see the kids again. I got news for you again. We're not seeing the kids again now as things are.
I was going to say, if that's the attitude, wow, yeah, wow. Well, I can't, we should continue this discussion on another show because there's a lot to unfold. And I'm sure listeners will have a lot to say. And in fact, they have a lot to say now. We got a lot of feedback from mm-hmm. listeners. We heard from Annalisa listening on KJMA. She emailed regarding Ash Wednesday. My grandpa was Native American and he was not Catholic. Am I reading the wrong ones? Yes, I am. I'm sorry. Y'all go ahead without
yeah,
me.
Yeah, so we have
the wrong one.
Yeah, regarding the order of the sacraments, we have a listener that texted, as a Chaldean, in our rite, infants still receive baptism and confirmation at the same time. I wish confirmation was later, as is in Latin rite. It is a beautiful understanding of the faith.
Okay. Laura, listening to Morning Glory Sirius XM channel 130, sent a text. Sacraments in the proper order? 1,000 times yes. Our youth need this more now than ever.
Mildred Jefferson, Mary Ellen emailed us regarding Mildred Jefferson. Good morning, Morning Glory team. I am so delighted that you featured Dr. J this morning on Morning Glory. She was a personal friend of my parents, and we celebrated the holidays together. I particularly remember how genuinely loving she was through the years to my Aunt Barbara, who had Down syndrome. Beautiful.
Oh,
thank you so much, Mary Ellen.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, and then Michelle texted, can we eat eggs instead of meat on Friday?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, that's meat in potentia.
Yeah.
Well, you can eat eggs. You can eat eggs. Let's
What's
see, what do we have?
Tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow we're going to talk about on the battle theme of Lent.
And we'll also talk about, should Catholics be afraid of ghosts?
Ooh.
Brothers and sisters, make a good start to Lent. Take it one day at a time, right? Offer your sacrifices today. Become closer to the cross, and so that much closer to resurrection. May God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
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 This is Morning Glory. It's Catholic from coast to coast.
The Catholic Church sees the Eucharist as the source and summit of the Christian life, to which the other sacraments are oriented. Our Holy Mass is next on EWTN.